LegalizeFreedom.com. Why are we here? Where do we come from? Where are we going? From the nature of reality to the future of humanity. Beyond politics, poverty, and war. LegalizeFreedom.com.
Greetings and welcome once again to LegalizeFreedom.com. I'm your host Greg Moffat, and my guest today is Sean Chamberlain, who joins us to discuss surviving the future, culture, carnival, and capital in the aftermath of the market economy, a recently published companion piece to Lean Logic, A Dictionary for the Future and How to Survive It, which is the life's work of British economist David Fleming. When Fleming died unexpectedly in 2010, he left behind his great unpublished work, a masterpiece more than 30 years in the making. In it, he examined the consequences of an economy that destroys the very foundations, ecological, economic, and cultural, upon which it is built. Knowing that collapse is the only possible outcome, he asked and envisioned what will follow. Compiled by Fleming's close friend and collaborator Sean Chamberlain, Surviving the Future presents Fleming's insights in a more easily digestible form. Fleming foresaw the schisms and convulsions now shaking the economies of Europe, and was among the first in the world to reveal the ongoing pressure on oil supply and predict the subsequent growth in unconventional oil and gas with all its consequences. Fleming acknowledges, with honesty, the challenges we face, but rather than inducing despair, Lean Logic and Surviving the Future inspire optimism in the creativity and intelligence of humans to nurse our ecology back to health and to rediscover the importance of resilience, community, and culture. The shocks converging on our world will leave nothing in our lives unchanged. We cannot now avoid it, but it can be managed, mitigated, made survivable, and recognized as our species' toughest but greatest opportunity. Hello and welcome, Sean, and thank you so much for joining us once again on LegalizeFreedom.com.
Oh, it's a pleasure to be back, Greg.
Now, Sean, today we're going to be talking about the work of the late British economist David Fleming, in particular, two recently published books, Lean Logic, A Dictionary for the Future, and How to Survive It, his masterwork, really, and a boiled-down companion piece, which you have edited. That's entitled Surviving the Future, Culture, Carnival, and Capital in the Aftermath of the Market Economy. Before we dive into all of that, just tell listeners a little bit about you yourself, your background, and your work in general.
So my work goes under this broad banner of dark optimism, which is basically the viewpoint that I take when bright, shiny optimism drives me a bit mad, because I think, well, actually, there's quite a lot that isn't great right now. But nonetheless, there's a lot we can do to make the world better. And that's led me, as per our previous conversation a few years ago, to be involved with the Transition Towns movement. I wrote the second book of that movement and co-founded Transition Town Kingston. Until recently, I was chair of a thing called the Ecological Land Cooperative. And I've been very involved with work around the sort of gift economy. One of my closest friends is a guy called Mark Boyle, who's often known as the Moneyless Man. We've done a lot of work together around potentially developing a moneyless community. And as you mentioned, most recently, I've been working on my sort of late mentor, David Fleming's books.
Okay, now, what we're talking about here, if there's a headline, just so people know, is the state of the world we're in. We're talking about the environment, about the economy, about energy, about your future, my future, the future of everyone listening to this, and in fact, everyone on the planet. You know, it's that big. And it was this that you're concerned with, I am, and that David Fleming very much was. So before we begin to talk just about these subjects and his work in particular, you knew him, as I say, he passed on not so long ago. Just for listeners who don't know, just tell us a little bit about the man that you came to know and his life and work.
Okay, so David Fleming was born, I think, in 1940, and he was involved in the UK with the creation of the Green Party here, worked very closely with his good friend Jonathan Porritt to kind of get that up and running as a serious force over here. But then, as Jonathan has told me, at the time he was sort of speaking to his peers and saying, well, it's always the economists who tell us that, you know, this is all realistic, that all this ecological mumbo-jumbo isn't practical. And so he was urging his peers back in the 70s that, you know, we need to learn the language of economics so that we can engage with and confound this mainstream. And being good to his word, he went off and got himself a PhD in economics eventually, and was involved in a thing called the Other Economic Summit, which was a sort of counter summit to the G7, as it was at the time, I think. And that led to the birth of what's now the New Economics Foundation in this country. He was also a chair of the Soil Association, which is an organization that cares about the soil, clearly, and particularly about organic farming. And his academic background before economics was in history, and you can see both of those things very much in his work. And then later, the Transition Towns movement was very firmly based in David's thinking and writing. So Rob Hopkins, who's a good friend of mine, often says that, very humbly, I might say, but he often says that he didn't really do much when he pulled Transition Towns together as a concept. All he did was he took Richard Heinberg on peak oil, David Holmgren on permaculture, and David Fleming on community and resilience, rolled the three together, and that was transition. And all he had to do was sort of make it comprehensible and show it to the world. You know, as I say, I think that downplays Rob's own role somewhat, but I think it does emphasize, in addition to the list of things you mentioned as sort of key issues of our times, what David was particularly exercised with was the kind of decline in culture, in sort of cohesive community, in carnival, in the joy of living. That was something which he was very occupied by, and a crucial thread that runs through his work, and which he argues ties in very much with, you know, the economic and ecological crises that you mentioned earlier.
Yes, and some listeners may already be at the stage where they're thinking, oh, these guys are going to have a really heavy conversation about environmental problems and economic crises and you know, all the problems that are facing us, and so many of them seem intractable, and, you know, just, I don't want to think about it, and et cetera, et cetera. But you mentioned your own phrase, dark optimism, and David's work regarding decline in culture and community and what have you is ultimately optimistic when you read his work, because that's what he's trying to say, I think, is that it is the re-emphasis and the re-nurturing of these aspects of what's really important to us as human beings. That is the thing that can get us through this ultimately, however bleak things seem. And that those things that will be reinvigorated with meaning are going to be what comes to redefine us once again, bearing in mind that they did for the longest period of time. It's only a relatively recent blip, actually, that we've become obsessed with all those things that aren't really our true nature, as it were. So, but just to set the scene here, before we get into some of the nitty gritty, I think we're going to do this maybe in two halves, you know, kind of what we're facing and then kind of what we're going to do about it. How would you characterize the sort of raft of problems that does, on the face of it, sometimes seem just to be a little too much for most people to cope with? How do you sum up the problem that we're facing as a species?
Wow, big question, huh? I think in a way it's something that resists summing up. I mean, it's what is often termed a wicked problem, that when we try and reduce it to some simple category, it resists that. But what I think we can do is pull on some of the core threads that run through all of that. And one of those is this decline in what David calls the informal economy, or what many people call the gift economy, the idea that within our culture, we used to depend very much on each other and on our relationships. And increasingly, we've come to depend on money and the markets to secure the things that we need. So, you know, whereas perhaps before you knew the person who was growing your food or providing your tools, now you very rarely do. And so what you perceive as being the thing that you're reliant on is the money and the markets that bring the goods to you, rather than the actual people who are doing that. And actually, that's something which leaves us less happy as people, because we have this idea that independence is a kind of responsible thing, and particularly this idea of financial independence. Whereas in fact, arguably, it's something of a myth, because, you know, no matter how much money you've got, it's still someone somewhere grew your food and made your clothes and produced everything that you use. It's just that if you get that stuff via money, you don't necessarily know the people that you're reliant on. And so money introduces this sort of distance between you and the people that you rely on. And David argues that re-associating with the people that we rely on creates that sense of loyalty and that sense of community and actually that sense of mutual reliance, which is actually reassuring and joyful and allows for a shared cultural understanding, which is something which is not only desirable for its own sake, as we were saying, in terms of the culture of it all, but also is the only thing in human history that's actually provided a resilient model for going forward that doesn't quietly sort of shunt off huge quantities of waste into the background and pretend that it's not there.
Yes, well, we think of, like, you know, some people who appear to have everything on the surface, you know, materially or in terms of kudos or, you know, fame, fortune, all the rest of it. And it's common to read stories of so-and-so being in terminal depression or suicidal or whatever, because all we really have and what matters to us, it seems, is other people. It's our relationships. And, you know, no man is an island and what have you. We think of, you know, Midas and everything he touched turning to gold, the emptiness that he ultimately experienced in life. And there's a very important point you make there about economic independence, as you say, being a myth. I've certainly, particularly now with the tensions in society with, you know, haves and have nots, and people need to, you know, bootstrap themselves up even when it's become harder and harder to do so. And self-made people sort of saying, well, you know, I did it. And the idea that someone who can't quite make a go of it financially, who finds themselves unable to find work or homeless, even, God forbid, they've somehow failed. And there might be individual failings or things that have gone wrong in people's lives, but it is a network, an interdependent network. And I think that one of the things that happens when we introduce money as a bottom line and the economy as the sort of the meta system that's supposed to trump everything else, that we do lose sight of all those connections on a simplistic level, you know, in terms of people, say, going into the supermarket and not knowing where the food comes from. As you say, they can have all the money they want. They can go in and buy filet mignon and caviar. But somewhere down the line, there's also rafts of people producing all this stuff, to say nothing of natural resources and animals and fish and plants and all the rest of it.
But it creates this very powerful disconnect, I think, because, as you say, the reality is that it's a web of interconnection. But the kind of story we tell ourselves is that almost like these goods magically appear, and as long as you've got money, you can just magically take them, and there's sort of nothing more to be said about it. And actually, I think this disconnect is one of the things that's underlaid the whole Brexit situation in the UK recently. Actually, I heard a wonderful interview you did with John Michael Greer on the topic, and he was talking about this sense of identity as being key, that people are no longer knowing what it means, like who is my community, and what are we? What is it to be British? What is it to be English? What is it to be a resident of London or Leicester or Tiverton? And because, as you say, the people who are falling through the cracks are being told by that cultural story that they're failures, we see this real rejection of a kind of globalization and neoliberalism, because it is not just destroying our collective future, but destroying the present of huge numbers of people who are being ground into the dirt. And John Michael Greer was making a very important point that the likes of Mussolini and Hitler were not just coming to power on the basis of fear of others and hate mongering, but raised wages and addressed unemployment and improved working conditions. And if that's seen as the only alternative to the sort of globalized neoliberal agenda, then it's not surprising that it's going to get a lot of support. And this is why I feel particularly proud to have brought these books of David Fleming's to publication just now, because for me, they lay out not only an understanding of some of the issues that have led to Brexit and indeed to Trump's election now in the US through the emphasis that they place on this sense of identity, but also, I think, a really beautiful vision of what Brexit could be, an alternative economic system based on trust and on loyalty and on diversity, which provides a beautiful vision of how we can help the desperate rather than that rather despicable vision, which seems to be gathering force at the moment.
Yes, as you say, that the Brexit outcome for some people, a shock for other people who were actually paying attention, not surprising at all. And some of us also saw Trump coming from a mile off. Over in the US. We'll talk a little bit more about those issues later on. Let's just look at the system that we're laboring under. And I want to talk about growth, because David Fleming addresses this obviously, as all economists do, whether they're saying that it's the only model that works and it's a must-have, or whether they're saying that it's impossible as things stand. We have a system, generally speaking, it's not utterly global, but it applies to industrial civilization, which most of us are living in, and increasing numbers of people wish to live in for the supposed benefits that it accrues. And infinite growth on a finite planet is the model, even though it's not stated as such. Mm-hmm. But that's what it boils down to. And that is obviously impossible. And yet, I was listening to the radio news today on the BBC, and I didn't even note what the particular news items were about, but I heard about growth, will be disappointing, or, growth is improving. And this is within the UK, within the EU, within North America, particularly people are talking about the economy over there in the wake of the election result. Growth, growth, yep. growth, growth, growth. And there's a reason why this is touted as an essential for our well-being. And ultimately, it's because the system's constructed so the economic system will not survive unless it grows constantly. But of course, it can't do that, but it must do that. Now, there's a problem there. What grows in nature without limit? Well, we can just think of something like a cancer, perhaps. And even that has, we all know what happens at the end of that.
It destroys its host, right?
Yeah, exactly. So say a word about growth, really, because I think for a lot of people, we're slaves to this language. It's almost like the meaning of words has become morphed and twisted to the point where we can't think about them logically anymore. And I even hear, never mind politicians who generally know next to nothing about economic theory, but even economists who, and I studied economics formally, what a waste of time that was, except perhaps it was an education in itself and the redundancy of classical economics. But talk to economists who are kind of like saying, when you've talked it through with them, oh, okay, so you're saying that growth can't continue forever. But no. But look at this graph. Look at this chart. And what they're not thinking about is what we've actually got, which is a planet. We've got resources. They're not finite. Some of them are renewable if we give them a chance. Some of them are not. Mm-hmm. So just address the growth paradigm.
Yeah. I mean, those kind of conversations tend to be where you're implicitly inviting someone to step outside of their paradigm. And they're thinking about it for a moment, and then mind is boggling because you can't sort of do that at the click of your fingers. And hence jumping back to a graph or something that they're very comfortable on and would much rather talk about. But yeah, I mean, so as you said, under the current economic paradigm, the only way we can keep unemployment from rising to the point where the population can't be supported is through endless economic growth. So that becomes seen as an obligation and seen as the key central duty of government. But as you say, we're sort of damned if we grow and damned if we don't. And in practice, what we're doing is just sort of keeping on growing and crossing our fingers that somehow the mathematical inevitabilities of that never come home to roost. And I think what Fleming's seemingly radical from our present point of view, but actually historically proven alternative, is actually not so much degrowth, which is the thing that a lot of people are talking about, because he would say that that's, again, focused on the market economy and whether it grows or doesn't grow. And he makes the point that actually, because the market economy is completely dependent on growth, people who are advocating for the end to that growth, he often quotes the line, "War is sweet to those who know it not." If we've lived through a period of continual growth, then we don't actually realize how devastating it would be to the economy that we all currently rely on if we shifted into degrowth. So instead, his focus is on, if you like, a different kind of growth, growth in the informal economy, growth in the non-monetary economy, which is the core economy that allows our societies to exist even today. This is the economy of family, of friendship, of home, of all the things that, whereas now some people might pay a counselor before you would talk to a friend. Some people might pay an escort to go to an event with. And so this core monetary economy, the economy that teaches us all how to speak, that raises us, that feeds us, has been vastly weakened and pushed out and wounded by the invasion of the market. And so what Fleming advocates is, we need to nurture that back to health. And in fact, that's something that so many people long for is the rediscovery of this sort of sense of community and the economy of what we love, really, the things that we naturally do when we're not being paid to do something else. But he shows that it's not just some sort of quaint and obsolete shared longing, but an actual practical priority, because, as you say, the end of monetary growth, the end of growth in the monetary market economy is inevitable, whether we hasten it or try and delay it. Either way, it's inevitable. And so the important thing is to grow the alternative so that when the monetary economy does inevitably hit the buffers, we've got something there to catch us, which has unfortunately been atrophying over the last couple of hundred years. And this is, I think, a really great moment to read a section from David's book where he addresses this very directly, not least because you were saying about it becoming quite dark and dense. And one of the wonderful things about David's writing, I think, is that he has a very warm tone. One of the reviewers described it as a book that you read with the sense that the author is winking at you in a friendly fashion all the way through it. So, yeah, maybe we can give the listeners a taste of that. So he writes, "The great transformation has already happened. It was the revolution in politics, economics, and society that came with the market economy and which hit its stride in Britain in the late 18th century. Most of human history has been bred, fed, and watered by another sort of economy, but the market has replaced, as far as possible, the social capital of reciprocal obligation, loyalties, authority structures, culture, and traditions with exchange, price, and the impersonal principles of economics. The market's achievements and answers sound authoritative and final, but what is truly most significant about them is how naive they are. If the flow of income fails, the powerfully bonding combination of money and self-interest will no longer be available on its present all-embracing scale, and perhaps not at all, and it must inevitably fail, as the market's taught competitiveness demands ever-increasing productivity and thus relies on the impossibility of perpetual growth. In the meantime, the reduction of a society and culture to dependence on mathematical abstraction has infantilized a grown-up civilization and is well on the way to destroying it. Civilizations self-destruct anyway, but it is reasonable to ask whether they have done so before with such enthusiasm, in obedience to such an acutely absurd superstition, while claiming with such insistence that they were beyond being seduced by the irrational promises of religion. Every civilization has had its irrational but reassuring myth. Previous civilizations have used their culture to sing about it and tell stories about it. Ours has used its mathematics to prove it. Yet, when this relatively short-lived market society is gone, we will miss its essential simplicity, its price mechanism, its self-stabilizing properties, its impersonal exchange, the comforts it delivers to many and the freedoms it underwrites. Its failure will be destructive, and the end is in sight. During the early decades of the century, the market will lose its magic. It is the aim of lean logic to suggest some principles for repairing or replacing the atrophied social structures on which most human cultures were built as the basis for a cohesive society that might survive the turbulent times to come."
Yeah, I think that if there was anything that I would take away from having read David's work now, it's maybe just that last line or that last half of the line, you know, just what lies beyond all of this. It's not something alien. It's not something unknown, it might be unknown to some people in our time, but it's actually getting back to something, not going back, because, you know, there's no going back in many senses. But there's a phrase in the book, which again, I'll come on to later on in the carnival section about when he talks about our second nature. I love to think of it as true nature, if you see what I mean. And one of the things I found most difficult to get to grips with when I was studying economics was trying to actually relate it to my life or the world of sort of interactions that I experience daily. And not just the stuff that we spoke about earlier about our interactions as members of families, friends and social circles and how we do these things with each other and for each other without thinking about money or markets or value or price or any of the rest of it. You know, that's most of life happens in that way. But also just even the actual economic interactions I would have in spending money on goods and services and other people doing the same. And just that the day-to-day economy of, you know, of exchanges with, if not complete strangers, then certainly people who are not part of your family or your circle of friends. I struggle to even relate that economic activity to the stuff that was up on the blackboard or the whiteboard, if you see what I mean. I just think it just, it became so utterly detached from it. And I think the problem arose was instead of trying to use economic models or ideas or theories to try and understand how human systems work and how they could be improved or optimized or understood, that we almost took these abstractions and then tried to impose them onto human systems and saying they now have to conform to this set of rules and parameters. And of course, it doesn't work like that. You know, it's like trying to herd cats, isn't it? You know, it's good luck with that, you know?
Yeah. I mean, coming back to what you were saying a moment ago about the rediscovering some of the principles we've lost, one of my favorite lines from the book is David writes, "We know what we need to do. We need to build the sequel to draw on inspiration, which has lain dormant like the seed beneath the snow." And yeah, that really sums up the counterpart to what you're talking about, which he also sums up by saying, I think it was something like, "The trouble is that some people learn their economics in an engaging scale model landscape and then find it terribly painful to leave it." And one of the interesting things that's come out for me over the last couple of months since the books come out and people have been reviewing them and responding to them is that while some people have been saying what a delight it is, much as you were sort of referencing there, to read a book which intertwines elements like carnival and religion and eroticism into a discussion of economics. And we've sort of been trained to think that these things have absolutely nothing to do with each other. Whereas I remember for myself when I was trying to grapple with economics, coming at it from a transition point of view and sort of asking David to help me get a handle on things. And I found it very helpful that he defined economics for me and just said, well, it's about who gets to use what resources and who does what. And that's everything, isn't it? That's, you know, there's an economics of everything in that case. And yet we're constantly told that it's all about, yeah, mathematics and graphs, when in fact it's really much more about politics and language in many ways.
So let's talk about another key aspect of our predicament, as the aforementioned John Michael Greer would have it. You know, we don't have a problem, we have a predicament. And predicaments don't necessarily have a way out or a solution. Certainly not one that allows you to just revert to, you know, business as usual. And that is energy. Because the economy that we're discussing, the industrial economy, is something of a temporary blip, as I mentioned earlier. And that has been facilitated by cheap, abundant energy. It was from the Industrial Revolution, the fossil fuel boom associated with the centuries thereafter, and we're starting to stare the end of that in the face at the moment. And it's one of the, you know, problems that we're increasingly running into wherever we turn. The doom mongers in some of these areas, particularly in the area of peak oil, it's very easy to, again, produce statistics and say that the doom mongers are in fact wrong. And in fact, there's plentiful oil and there's no shortage. And it might be a question of where the price is at the moment. And it's a price actually that's affecting supply. Yet demand can be affected by other economic factors and that can affect production, yada, 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 as if the supply of fossil fuels is somehow infinite and that it just goes up and down depending on a few other, you know, human whims and economic factors and what have you. But that's very, very key, because all of this flurry of activity in the last few centuries, of which we have ridden perhaps the crest of a wave, you and I in our generation, or certainly maybe our parents did, that's debatable, that's not going to go on forever. And that's another central plank of David's analysis, is just how we're going to manage that and what life's going to look like after that, you know, as the transition happens. Mm-hmm. 50 years from now, 100 years from now, 200 years from now. These are the sort of timescales we're looking at. Another reason I might add that a lot of people struggle to deal with it and also find it very tempting to sort of say, ah, well, you know, somebody else's problem. But
yeah, well, Colin Campbell was one of the sort of great initial pioneers of peak oil. And he often makes the point that everyone's fixated on when the peak will be, but that's not really the point. The point is the long slope down after it that goes on for hundreds of years, as you say. And yeah, David Fleming was one of the kind of key people in breaking the peak oil story. So Colin Campbell and he were good friends. And in, I think it was 1999, David Fleming wrote an article for Prospect magazine called The Next Oil Shock, which was based on work they'd been doing with Colin Campbell. And interestingly, Fatih Birol, who was working at the International Energy Agency, is now still, I believe, the chief economist there, actually got in touch with David Fleming and said, look, we need to meet. And so they met in London, and he basically confessed to David then, like, you're right. There are maybe six people in the world who understand what you put in your article, and it's going to have a massive thing. So it was for David, I know, a very pivotal moment in his life that, you know, he published this article and found that someone who was at the very heart of the international assessment of our energy situation sort of was so struck by this that he came and met with him. So this, as you say, is absolutely a core element in David's work, is how do we build an economy that's that's not only a lower energy future because of climate change, because as he pointed out to me, you know, he saw that these unconventional energy reserves, you know, your shale, etc., would be the natural response to an energy crisis. You know, as the cheap, easy oil becomes less available, that's the natural response, unless we're taking our climate change obligations seriously. So he was very aware 20 years ago that we were going to end up with this real tension between the energy crisis and the climate crisis. And of course, it seems at the moment that the approach that we're taking is just to ignore the climate crisis and burn everything we can get our hands on to keep the party going a little bit longer, as it were, before we face the consequences. Unfortunately, it's a bit like a trip to the dentist. The longer you leave it, the worse it's going to be. But there's still that temptation to leave it a little bit longer. And yeah, David's work then was all about how do we create a future that's sustainable and resilient, but also desirable, also convivial, also built around music and joy and culture. And that's why his work was such an inspiration for Transition, which Rob often says is, you know, all about figuring out what activism would look like if it were more like a party than a protest march. And just, I think last month, I was at Oxford University with Jonathan Porritt doing an event around the launch of the books. And he was really emphasizing how that sense of conviviality, of life well lived, was absolutely at the heart of everything that David did. And what makes it such a compelling vision? I mean, I think for me, the thing that inspired me about David's writing that led me to spend the last few years on bringing it to publication after his death was that it is just the most compelling vision of a future that I've yet found. Yeah, it really got me amped up to want to devote myself to getting these books out there. And judging by the reactions the books are having, I think it's one that's getting a lot of other people excited about a positive alternative that isn't purely fictional, like a lot of the sort of cornucopian ideas can be.
Yeah, I think it's telling. You mentioned the subject of climate change there. And when I bring this up, or when this comes up in interviews, I often insert the caveat that people can think what they like about climate change or global warming or whatever, however you like to express this sort of, like, you know, constellation of effects that appear to be going on in the world at the moment. You can think what you like about the causes of that, but it's happening, you know. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to go into conspiratorial realms. You don't have to have any axe to grind politically or anything. We're observing effects, okay? They're just happening. So whether it's down to human activity or not is sort of by the by. I can understand why some people say, oh no, but that's key, because if it's human activity, then we can do something about it. For me, it's really very much about it's happening. I like to defuse the issue for me personally, just by observing what is happening out the window, where when I walk around, you know, in terms of temperature, in terms of precipitation or lack of it here at home, abroad, you know, wherever it happens to be, what I see in the news, what I read in reports, this stuff is actually occurring, particularly when you hear reports from people who are living through it, not, you know, climate scientists or economists, God forbid, or anyone else, politicians. There are changes happening on the earth. That's just the way it is. And I think it's telling that in terms of the tension that you mentioned between addressing climate change and dealing with economic crises, vis-a-vis keeping the growth bubble going in the teeth of enormous problems, that the various international climate agreements that have come along in recent times have either been non-binding or they've been toothless or some combination of the two. Yeah. And when the you-know-what hits the fan, politicians have chosen growth. They have chosen globalization over and above any kind of environmental concern when it comes down to it. And that just tells you where they're at in terms of what they think the public at large will swallow.
Yeah, I mean, if we're avoiding taking the trip to the dentist, nobody's going to vote for the guy who says, look, we really need to go to the dentist today. Well, no, no, we don't. Let's put it off a little bit longer. And I mean, also, you know, in terms of your diffusing the conversation, I mean, it's also not necessarily the case that because it's human caused, we can do something about it. Of course, it might be the case that it's human caused, but we've left it too late to do anything about it, that we've sort of started something in motion, which has now got a momentum of its own that's out of our control. So the two questions aren't necessarily interlinked. But one of the things that I find very interesting about David's work, I mean, you're probably familiar with the Dark Mountain movement. I went and did a presentation about the books at their festival a couple of months ago, and they're very much looking at the kind of space of, well, you know, what if there actually isn't much that we can do about climate change? Not because we deny that it's a real thing, or we deny that humans have caused it, but that actually it might be just too late to turn the tanker of our economic system, and there may just be too many physical consequences already in train. And what was very interesting was that that audience also responded extremely positively to David Fleming's work, because I think it doesn't depend on our vision of the future. And this is something that David emphasizes very much in the book, that we don't need to spend all our time arguing about, you know, is this kind of collapse scenario more likely, or is a sort of long descent scenario more likely, or is a utopian future more likely? No, what we need to do is spend our time rebuilding the seeds of success, the seeds of the future culture that we want to live in. There's another wonderful wonderful extract I could read, actually, the dictionary entry on success in Lean Logic, which is literally a dictionary for the future and how to survive it. And that says, "Do you really think that we will get through these times of multiple crises and come in due course to a time of resilience and manners? Don't answer that question. For you may discover to your cost that your answer is either a self-fulfilling or a self-denying truth, and that both count against us. If we deny that there is a livable future, then we will do little to secure one. If we affirm it, we come into other troubles, such as complacency, an optimistic view that what we are doing now is all that is needed, an iconic focus on the simple solution, or the constant anxiety of life on the edge between hope and doubt. Positive thinking seems to be the right thing in circumstances until you notice the wreckage. Instead, think of what happened to Orpheus and Eurydice. Eurydice, you may remember, died after having been bitten by a snake, and Orpheus went down into the underworld to recover her. The goddess Persephone agreed to let her go on condition that Orpheus did not look back at her as she followed him. Unfortunately, he forgot about this condition. He did look back, with the result that Eurydice vanished forever, and Orpheus was torn to pieces by angry women who threw his head into the river Hebros, where it floated downstream, still singing. That is, make the intense commitment, at walking pace, plod on, climb steeply uphill, out of the underworld, keep your eyes fixed ahead. You never know, you might get there, you might even find out where there is, and you might inspire others to come with you. Just don't look back. We do not need to choose between hope and expectation. What matters is to keep hope alive, which we won't succeed in doing if we are constantly checking up on it. It is not certainty that sustains our focus, but the ambiguity that comes to us, for instance, in the prayer from another ancient moment of commitment against the odds. Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief." And I think that really emphasizes the place that we're in now. I don't think anyone looks at the world today and says, everything's fine. I can't see any problems with how the world is right now. But it's incredibly difficult to say, you know, this is the critical problem. But what we absolutely can do is set our eyes on where we want to get to. Someone said, throw an anchor into the future that you want to live in and pull yourself along by the chain. And that is what David's work is all about, and really providing not a top-down model of how we get there, but tools for bottom-up conversations and principles that will be useful as we figure out together where we want to get and how we're going to get there.
Yeah, your sort of invocation of the past there in that tale makes me think about those who came before us, you know, and from ice ages to fire from the sky, God knows what beset the people who came before us in millennia gone by. We've been to the edge of extinction.
Mm-hmm.
And we have come back and come back and come back. And the idea, we've just become so, in many ways, so soft with our TV dinners and our smartphones, and the idea that it's like that we're facing an insurmountable challenge, when for me, and I've discussed these general issues that we're talking about here many times with many different thinkers and commentators, mm-hmm. researchers, writers, and one of the biggest obstacles, perhaps the most active battlefront, is the mind. It's psychology. It's the imagination. It's what the, you know, the, what's possible in your mind. That's where everything takes place first with human beings before it becomes reality. And I think that's one of the biggest things that we're facing. One of the biggest hurdles is coming to terms with the problems that are, and let's not joke about here, they're not just coming down the line. Many of them are here right now. And so it's the idea that coming to terms with them, thinking that there can be something beyond that, and then getting beyond it not just on behalf of ourselves, but on behalf of others. I often speak to people who say, I can't deal with this. I can't deal with this. I've got children. I've got to think about their future. So, and as my, in my interview with John Michael Greer, as he pointed out, so you're going to think about your children's future by not thinking about their future, as it were. So for me, that's a huge thing. I think that if you can get over some of these things psychologically, whether it is dealing with what we're facing or imagining a better future or seeing your life as perhaps doing less or having more of different things or doing more of different and better things, that's an enormous Rubicon, I think.
Well, and I think we shouldn't be too glib about that. You know, we shouldn't just say, well, come on, people, you know, this is happening and you've got to deal with it and get a grip. You know, I think all of us who are engaging with this stuff in a way that we find that we consider meaningful have been through those dark nights of the soul or whatever you want to call them, where it is just overwhelming. And, you know, I don't think we can pretend that we were just able to, you know, click our fingers and suddenly take all this stuff in without some tears and some emotional challenges. And one of my sort of great frustrations is that it seems to me whenever I hear people arguing about what should be done, there's always, it's the same argument all the time. There's someone on one side saying, you know, there's no time for radical change or revolution. You know, this is overwhelmingly urgent. We've just got to act within the frameworks we've got now, whatever they're talking about, whether it's, you know, climate change or economics or whatever. And the other side saying, but there's no point in that. You know, if we don't have radical change or revolution, then we're just dealing with symptoms and we're not dealing with the real problems. And I've heard that argument so many times in so many contexts, it gets so boring. Because every time, the reason those debates are never resolved, the reason why they go on all night or all career even, is because they're both right. Yes, the crisis is overwhelmingly urgent, and yes, we need radical change, and there isn't time for it. And until we can actually have the emotional maturity to actually sit down and admit that both those things are right, and sit with that and go, well, hang on, where does that leave us? Because, you know, does that just leave us in despair, in giving up? You know, surely that's no use. But when you actually sit with those deeper questions rather than saying, well, I've got kids, I can't even think about it, then you start to see some, what would you say, deeper grounds for hope, in that ultimately sustainability is not possible. Ultimately, you know, based on the latest physics, the universe will end at some point, you know, our sun will burn out, you know, in the long, long, long term, sustainability is not possible. So if we make that our God, then we will fail our God. And that can really hurt. But if we sit with the pain of this impossible predicament that we're in, then, you know, we cry our tears and we rage and we do whatever we do. And we feel like it's unbearable and it's going to end us, but it doesn't end us. And we wake up eventually one day, and it's somehow empowering to have faced that. It's like it takes a huge amount of psychic energy to suppress that fear and that despair and that, oh my God, I can't possibly look at it. And when we actually look at it, and then we're still alive the next day, and maybe we do genuinely believe on the basis of our analysis that there's nothing we can do about the fact that this civilization is going to collapse. Well, then, okay, if that's what you believe, then what are you going to do in that context? And suddenly the question feels less sort of desperate and anxious and becomes just, what story do I want to tell with my life? And I think that's, for all of us, the fundamental question. You know, what story do I want to tell with my life? I want to tell a story that I'm proud to tell. And if I was born into a suicidal, ecocidal, omnicidal culture, well, there is still love to do in that context. There's still good ways to live a life and tell a story that's meaningful in that context. And, you know, we're all going to die ultimately. Everyone's kids are going to die because that's part of the nature of being alive. The point of life is not to make it last forever. It's to make it meaningful. And once you can face the genuine, you know, and I say we can't be too glib about this, the genuine awfulness of some of the things that are happening in the world and are likely to happen in the future, then we can release the energy to actually get on with living the story we want to live with our lives, with actually, you know, spending wholehearted time with our children and engaging with them about these issues and finding out what they think about them, rather than trying to protect them from a reality that is inevitably going to impinge on their lives. So, yeah, I think you're absolutely right that it's these sort of mental and emotional processes that are core. But we have to be a little gentle, I think, about encouraging people to get a grip and appreciate just what an essential but difficult task that is.
Yeah, and in the dark ages, And there have probably been many of those in human history. People live and love and laugh, and they have kids, and they make music, and they create art, and write poetry, and build things, and, you know, and all the rest of it. So that's part of who we are, an expression that, and many people would say, especially many creative people would say, it is spurred on by challenges of darker times. And when you initially said that, one thought was, leads on to a topic that I want to come on to now, and I suppose it's a little bit dark, and that's the idea that not everyone's going to make it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, we know we deal with these big issues every day with our own mortality. We still, most of us, find a way to get up in the morning and go out there into the world and interact and do all the things I described, knowing in our deepest core that one day, and it could be today, you know, that's the end. We mm-hmm. still somehow manage to get on with it. But not everyone's going to make it, and that brings me onto the subject of population.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're already seeing some of the, although, you know, world population continues to expand, we're seeing some medium to long-term kind of trends starting to play out in developed countries with reductions, if not in overall population, then reductions in indigenous population. But we're also seeing some of the factors playing out that commentators on population generally cite as maybe some of the less obvious factors that will come into play to reduce population, whether we like it or not. You know, if our population doesn't naturally sort of reduce to fit in with ecosystems and resources and what have you, then it'll be forcibly reduced. And I think not that many people maybe are looking at the Middle East, perhaps, with war and associated starvation. I mean, we've had problems with food supply in Africa for the longest time, but maybe they're not looking at the current Middle East situation and saying perhaps there's a bit of a population rebalancing going on there. Some people would say there is, actually. We don't like to think about it that way, because when people talk about significant reductions in global population, it always seems like has to be very, very dramatic, you know, involving millions of people, you know, the sort of the Guy McPherson model here of, you know, mass die-offs and just, you know, corpses piled from here to the moon or whatever it happens to be.
Mm.
And it would seem, however, that the population in the world as it stands, not only would it be impossible for the world population to enjoy the sort of standard of living that you or I or people in our position or living in our sorts of industrialized economies enjoy or have the opportunity to enjoy, but even a more basic standard of living, say going back to that which our grandparents might have had, try applying that to 9 billion people and you've still got significant overshoot. So I don't know what your thoughts are, your personal thoughts about the population issue, what you drew out about that from David with your interactions with him, from his work. But it seems certain, does it not, that that's one of the most significant markers in terms of change in human society on the earth, whether it's a generation from now or 10 generations, that there probably won't be as many of us.
Well, yes, I agree. And one of the stages in my personal sort of thinking around all of this was actually during the course I did at Schumacher College, where I first met both Rob Hopkins and David Fleming, which was actually exactly 10 years ago now. I remember finding a book on the bookshelves at the college called The Population Bomb by Paul Ehrlich, which I think was written in the 70s. And I found it a very interesting read because it was predicting that the population bomb would explode, you know, that the population situation would hit these limits with terrible consequences well before the date at which I was reading the book. And it was an interesting read because a lot of the arguments he was making seemed to make sense to me. And so that led me to think, well, okay, if a lot of this makes sense, why is the future, or the present as it was for me, but the future that he was predicting, not like he predicted? And so I looked quite carefully at his assumptions. And basically, he was looking at the standards of living that he assumed that we would want for the world and multiplying that by the numbers of people. And I think that is where our present didn't follow the path that he predicted, because rather than trying to maintain a comparable standard of living for all the people whilst the population grew, instead, we've just seen more and more and more of the human population of the world living in awful circumstances. So the William Gibson has this wonderful line that the future is already here, it's just unevenly distributed. And in a way, more and more of the world is falling into that sort of dystopian future. And the circles of people who are sitting around going, oh, why hasn't the apocalypse happened yet, is sort of shrinking. But at the same time, I think it's very important to remember when faced with these kind of, I mean, again, as you said, it comes back to the mind and the emotions. And a lot of people, when faced with these issues, go straight to a kind of quite dark, doomerish kind of perspective. And it's really important to remember that these things have happened before. So in the mid-1300s in Europe, we had the Black Death. And, you know, something like a third to a half of the population died. And at the time, living through that, it must have seemed like the end of the world. You know, you can imagine all the people with their end is nigh placards. And, you know, this was pretty clearly the apocalypse to a lot of people, I'm sure, at the time. But, you know, one of the effects in the aftermath of that was that much more land became available per capita to those who did, in fact, survive the apocalypse. And this meant a better, more varied diet for the people who survived it and the freedom to experiment, which opened the way for a whole revolution in agricultural crops and techniques. And so it would be as wrong to deny the benefits that would be derived from a reduced population as it would be to welcome them. But we don't really need to do either. And this comes back to what we were saying before. Like, our job is not to predict the future or to draw a graph of population. You know, the whole core concept of resilience is to do things which make sense across a wide range of possible futures, not to predict the future and then prepare for it. And this is what I think is really critical in everything that we do. It's doing the things that make sense in the collapse scenarios and also make sense in the non-collapse scenarios, because there's plenty we need to do in those as well. And as David writes, the aim is sustaining a mannerly and decent civilization, as he puts it, despite the shocks. And we should not be distracted from this by uncertainty about the size of the population. What we do know is that in an economy with richly developed reciprocities, social capital and culture, it is possible to support institutions and practices which limit the growth of populations in humane ways. And one of the reasons why those limits failed was that those structures of social order declined, particularly gathering speed with the growth of the market economy. And then, as David lays out in the book, as that continued to grow, the larger population required an intensive urban industry to meet the need for more goods. And he has this wonderful illustration of this in the form of a description of some pots. That, you know, you start with someone sitting there with a simple desire, I would like some more pots for whatever reason. And then that leads to the need for more transport to get the pots to them, which leads to more transport infrastructures, which leads to more tax to pay for the roads, which leads to more bureaucracy to raise the tax, which leads to more jobs available in towns, which leads to larger towns, which leads to the dislocation of rural social structures, to the relaxation of sexual rules, to higher population, to the greater need for food and resources, to military conquest, to the flow of wealth into a growing society, and to ultimately the need for yet more pots. And this kind of economic understanding that, you know, these simple, the tyranny of small decisions that lead to these huge consequences, we're actually getting to the point now where we have enough of an understanding of systems thinking that we can look at that and say, well, we can start to deconstruct some of those, what David calls intermediate structures, the things we don't essentially want but are necessary for the things we do want. We can start to radically simplify the structures of our society so that we can begin to create a society which can allow for a humane reduction in population rather than just blindly charging on towards the cliff and saying, well, we don't know when the collapse is going to happen, but we'll deal with it when it comes. And that, you know, that is the case that David makes very strongly in his books. And I think it's far more important to get on with doing that in whatever ways we can than to speculate about which end of the spectrum of possibilities is likely to transpire.
Yeah, and this overlaps also with the idea about what people are going to do when they're not engaged in these sort of intermediate industries and activities. Obviously, we've been talking about this in the context of reduced population, but what people are going to do seems to be very important when we're talking about the kind of market economy that we're operating in, because everyone's got to pay their way. They've got to be economically independent, as you mentioned earlier. If they're not, then there's the question of welfare and benefits, how that gets funded, and on and on and on. And a lot of this is somewhat artificial, whether we consider the question of, you know, optimum population or where that might be or where it might settle. But just the system we've created puts a lot of pressure on people to be, as we mentioned, economically independent, and therefore quite often doing things that are not only ultimately unproductive, but actually damaging. And
yes.
We're seeing a situation now where it was brought home very clearly with David's work, where those things which cannot be automated, for example, like, nursing care, looking after the infirm or the elderly, mm-hmm. or helping or counseling those who are falling between the cracks, you know, as we mentioned earlier, these are not things that you can farm out to machines, computer programs. But there are things that are becoming increasingly expensive just as they're becoming more and more in demand. Mm-hmm. We see this tension now here in the UK with pressures on the National Health Service. We see it, I guess, in the USA with their healthcare system, you know, the tension between private and what Obama was attempting to do with his Obamacare. I can't remember what it was actually called, but we all think of it as Obamacare.
Yeah.
This artificial situation that in some ways is just stepping in and ineffectively and expensively attempting to take the place of what you referred to earlier, which is these natural reciprocal arrangements that we have in human societies of cooperation, which has now kind of been replaced by competition. These are issues that it's difficult to see how it is all going to shake out, but these are issues that can be resolved because we not only dealt with them effectively throughout most of our history, but our kind of stymied inability to deal with them now is an artificial byproduct of the economic system.
Well, absolutely. I mean, and this is the thing, we find it, I'm not sure who said it first, but a number of people have said we find it easier these days to imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism. And, you know, we're so, I guess the word is indoctrinated into our current economic system that we find it hard to imagine. Not just imagine that an alternative could come to pass, but just to imagine an alternative. And this is one of, you know, one of the most compelling parts of David's work is that a lot of people have argued that we need to make a lot of the changes that he's arguing that we need to make, but very often they're not based in a kind of grounded economic analysis, which, as I mentioned at the start of our interview, 40 years ago, he was making those arguments and then he thought, well, I need to go and ground myself in economics so that I can make sure that this is robust. And so what he lays out is an alternative economic framework that importantly is not something that we need to lobby governments to implement, because I think that's very often a problem with a lot of books that deal with the challenges we're facing these days, is that you get to the end of the book and they'll have outlined these huge problems and then they'll outline things we ought to do as a society to address those problems. But they don't say anything about how we get a system that's completely devoted to perpetuating itself to make these changes. They just say, we should do these things, and you agree, and then they never happen. Whereas David's work is very much about stuff that we as individuals and as communities can do. And of course, the transition towns is one example of people inspired by David's work getting together to do these things. And as you say, I mean, there's a wonderful line from Kirkpatrick Sale that Fleming quotes, where he's talking about these kind of state services like healthcare and regulatory agencies. And he says, there is not a one of them, not one, that has not in the past been the province of the community or some agency within the community and has been taken on by the state only because it first destroyed that province. And there is not a one of them that could not be reabsorbed by a community in control of its own destiny and able to see what its natural humanitarian obligations, its humanitarian opportunities would be. And I think that's absolutely core, is that it's actually all of these things were done in an informal community based way originally. And the big state has come in and destroyed those things by displacing them, by taking them over, by commandeering them. And so as the centralized, globalized structures continue to crack, as they are doing in the face of the various fundamental crises that we're facing, cracks and spaces open up where those things can be reclaimed by community, and people are increasingly doing this. And you don't hear about this in the mainstream media, but more and more places are just getting on with looking after themselves in ways that are actually far more nourishing and far more wonderful than a big centralized high-tech approach. I mean, you were asking about, you know, what will people do for jobs? I mean, it's such a strange question when you think about it. It's a very common question. It's such a strange question. We're looking at a future where there are almost an overwhelming number of things that need to be done. And we're saying, well, what will people do? You know, it's a very odd thing, but it's because we've been socialized into this idea that the only way we can support ourselves and our families is by earning money from somewhere and using that to pay for the things that we need. I could talk about my work with Mark Boyle on moneyless living, where he lived for 3 years completely moneylessly down near Bristol and found it was utterly doable. Wrote a wonderful book called The Moneyless Man about his first year, and then another book, The Moneyless Manifesto, as a sort of how-to guide for others who don't necessarily want to go all the way, but want to massively reduce their dependence on the monetary economy. And in my personal life, you know, I, 10 years ago, quit my job to engage with these big issues of our culture. And over the last 10 years, I've been living on maybe £5,000 a year so that I didn't have to earn very much money, so that I could spend all my time doing stuff that I'm really passionate about, which is, you know, better than anything you could buy with money anyway. And so it's very possible in one's personal life to reduce your dependence on the monetary economy. But looking at it from a more macroeconomic scale, as David Fleming does, your question really took me back to my childhood. And you may remember, Greg, the BBC program Tomorrow's World.
Oh yes, very well. That was your boil down of what to expect next year.
Yeah, absolutely. This is the future that technology will deliver us. You know, for me, I was watching that as a child, and I one thing that really stuck with me was that they were confidently assuring me that by now robots would be doing all the menial work, so, you know, humans would be free to relax and enjoy an abundance of leisure time. And one thing that was fascinating when I read David's work, which I actually only read after his death. So although David and I worked very closely on a number of things, he never let me look at Lean Logic because he said we were too close friends and it was too close to his heart. And if I didn't like it, we would fall out. And so it was only actually, as it turned out, about 2 months before his very sudden death that he first let me start looking at the book. So I only really read it, the vast majority of the book, in the aftermath of his death. And it came as a real shock to read from some of his historical research that in the Middle Ages, people were having leisure time holidays that totaled maybe a third of the year. And so, you know, I've been brought up to believe that we're living in this, you know, the most advanced civilization there's ever been and high technology and everything. I'm thinking, well, hang on, what gives? You know, people in the Middle Ages were working 2/3 of the year and spending the rest of the time in holiday. That seems kind of odd. And as you read on, David explains that in our current sort of competitive market economy, which is only a couple of hundred years old, if you have a technological advance that doubles the amount of useful work that a person can do in a day, say, that's almost a problem rather than a benefit, because it's likely to put half the people out of work and then they become this drain on the state. So, of course, in theory, all the workers could just decide to work half the hours, get paid the same, still produce everything that's needed. And that's what Tomorrow's World was predicting when I was a kid, right? That the robots would do most of the work and the people would just share out what was left and it would all be wonderful, which makes perfect sense, actually, except that our economic system doesn't allow us to do it. Because in practice, people are afraid of having their pay cut or losing their jobs to someone who's willing to work longer hours. And so, in fact, you know, we most commonly perceive the automation of processes as being a threat to jobs, which is purely a facet of our economic system. You know, it's not that those jobs are inherently rewarding. It's not that people love working on supermarket checkouts, and so we have to resist the automation of the process. It's only because that's the only way they're allowed to access the money that gives them the things that they need to feed themselves and house themselves and support themselves. And it's only in sort of mainstream economics that you have this concept of spare labor and a problem of unemployment, because, you know, that spare labor is the same thing as spare time, which, you know, we might naively imagine is actually a desirable thing in life, that we could actually spend our time in a self-directed way rather than being employed to do what someone else is asking us to do. And so this is where actually one reviewer of David's book put it beautifully. He said, when productivity improves in our system, you have a problem. In Fleming's system, you have a party. And so David really emphasizes that the beauty in, for example, the Middle Ages of these great holidays is that they weren't just time where people lazed around and did nothing productive and slacked off. It was time when people were feasting and performing and collaborating and merrymaking and bonding. And it's those cultural ties that we desperately miss these days, because nobody has time for them, because they're all working sort of 60-hour weeks to desperately scrape together the money that we've made essential in an economy where everyone's a specialist and nobody knows how to grow their own food, for example. You have to have some kind of other way of accessing it. And so this is why it's so refreshing, I think, in David's work. He isn't just laying out, oh, wouldn't it be nice if we went back to a time when everyone knew each other and we all got on? No, what he's actually doing is laying out a rigorous economic system that provides a basis for that, and which we can get on with now, which we can right now start reducing our dependence on the monetary economy. We can start spending more time in our communities and our cultures and our families and rebuilding those informal networks and regrounding them in ecology, ultimately, because all finance and economics is ultimately a claim on ecological resources, on food or other resources. And as we do that, we make it possible for us to take that trip to the dentist. As we learn to support ourselves in ways that aren't dependent on the market economy, it becomes thinkable to imagine being able to survive in a post-market growth world. And that vision is what we so desperately need today. And this is why, for me, getting these books out to the world feels like probably the most important work that I've done in my life so far. Because if we can repair those atrophied social structures on which most human cultures have been built and rediscover how to rely on each other again rather than on money alone, then we can not only face up to the economic growth problem that seems completely intractable at the moment and all the environmental problems that flow from that, but also technological progress can finally start bringing us the fruits it had always promised. We could actually live in a more leisurely world rather than one where we're desperately competing against each other all the time for an insufficient supply of money.
Yes, going back to what you were saying about Tomorrow's World TV program, I have to say that leisure surely is the great unfulfilled promise of economic development. I remember all too well, and I'm considerably older than you, every techno-utopian piece of BS that I read that was written during the 50s, 60s, 70s, you know, even in the 70s with the oil shock, you know, people were still peddling this stuff. It was like the Jetsons, you know, writ large. And it was, we're all going to be sitting in the park drinking wine and reading poetry and strumming acoustic guitars and, you know, stroking your girlfriend's hair or boyfriend's hair, whatever you prefer, you know. But yeah, there was going to be this time, you know, and it was while everything was automated. And even though we have seen intense industrialization of every aspect of production and delivery in our society, the computerization has been off the charts. I mean, the advances in IT, even in the last 10 years, never mind my lifetime, have been staggering. Yeah. But it seems somehow that the increased capacity has simply been filled a little bit like when governments build more roads as an attempt to address traffic congestion. What happens? The roads fill with cars. And it somehow seems that the more efficient manufacturing facilities that we build, the more powerful the microprocessors, all that capacity just gets filled. I'm not quite sure with what, but the net result seems to be that we don't have time for reading poetry in the park or drinking wine in the park or whatever. And we have this thing that seems to have kicked in at some point after the Middle Ages era that you describe, this thing about the sobriety, turning up on Monday morning, the Protestant work ethic. I don't know about you, but I was always taught that working hard was a good thing per se. You could be working hard at executing peasants. That doesn't matter. As long as you're working hard, as long as you're executing lots of peasants, you know, then so that's a virtuous thing. I'm being facetious there, but you know what I mean. It's like, it's not identifying what is worthwhile, what is good work, what is meaningful, and what helps yourself or other people. It's just productivity and whatever it happens to be. And some wag made the point that Nazi Germany was incredibly efficient. Did that make it, you know, a good thing? So, just on that note, I would just get you to comment on all of that, you know, this idea that we have that the busyness is a good thing and that productivity that, you know, is, should be the bottom line in our lives.
Well, yeah. So, I mean, I think there are two answers to where all that technological productivity has gone, you know, what we've poured it into. One is, you know, what I was just describing, that our whole economic system is based in a way that it almost turns increased productivity into a problem rather than a boon and doesn't allow us to, have that party or stroke that hair or have that leisure time. The other thing, of course, is the vast inequality in our society that, you know, that there are people now on the planet with just an obscene proportion of the money, which is, you know, ultimately tied back to the productivity. And so that vast inequality means that, of course, they, if they so desired, could spend their time stroking their partner's hair, whereas the majority of people aren't able to do that because they're scrabbling around for what remains. But I think maybe the more nuanced aspect of all this is what you're talking about with the kind of ethics and the culture. And this is something which David Fleming's work ties in very beautifully, I think, to the economic story. So in one of the sections of the book is called Rediscovering a Life of Place and Play, and covers things like carnival and like eroticism and like religion, and talks about some of the utopian fantasies, indeed, that you've been referencing, but weaves those in to the economic story. So the realization that, you know, one of the things those people in the Middle Ages spent their time doing was putting on this incredible sort of calendar of celebrations and carnivals and rituals. And part of those, you know, part of the function, if that's not too prosaic a word, of those was to develop these sort of cultural facilities in our minds, of these cultural senses of, you know, what it is to be emotionally daring in the way that we're saying that people need to do to deal with the realities of our present time. But maybe we've never learned to do those things because our culture hasn't provided us with a context in which to learn those kind of skills, because they are emotional skills. Or we've lost this very often, this sense of consciousness of time and events, the passing of the seasons, you know, in a world that's filled with artificial light and spent staring at screens, the passing of the seasons can completely be a mystery to us. And the sense of locality, the lessons that we can learn from art. So there's a passage in both books, in Lean Logic and in Surviving the Future, where David talks about the story of Odysseus and the sirens who are singing to him from the shore. Yeah, so in the book, David tells the story or draws on Homer's story of the Odyssey, and I'll read a section from that. Homer tells us how the art of the ancient dream world lay in wait to seduce Odysseus and his crew as they were about to encounter the sirens, whose bewitching song lures everyone who hears it to their death, their bodies added to the pile of mouldering skeletons in the meadow where the sirens sat. On the advice of his mistress Circe, the goddess who lives on the island of Aea, Odysseus stopped up the ears of his crew with wax, so that, unable to hear the song, they were not distracted from the real work of rowing. He himself, being securely strapped to the mast, could now listen to the siren's voice with enjoyment, as Circe puts it, and without being drawn irresistibly into their power. This has various interpretations, but one of them makes it into a decisive detachment from art. The sound of ancient myth, which once drew its hearers in, without means of escape, is rendered sensible and civilized, reduced to a concert, a sort of Hellenic music evening with female chorus and a professor of Greek to tell us something about the local legend that lies behind it. On this view, we see the breaking of the link between art, music in this case, and politics. Now you only need to buy your ticket, be a spectator of the arts for an hour or so, and then home for herb tea and bed. And I think that's a very powerful description of this process whereby our culture has become sort of simplified in a cultural sense, that, you know, because we don't have time for anything other than getting up and being disciplined and going to work and coming home and watching a bit of lowest common denominator TV to numb our brains before we fall asleep again. We've lost a lot of the nuance and sensibility around, you know, what a rational argument looks like, or what the nature of truth is, you know, these kind of things which allow us to weigh the competence of the decision makers in our society and possibly reject those decision makers if we think that their decisions aren't up to scratch. As he says in that quote I read earlier, we've had our society infantilized, and that unfortunately is leading us to a point where numerous problems are sort of piling up all around us, but we're still just living within this very, very limited scope where we're not really raising our eyes to these problems and just focusing on what's immediately in front of us. And the arts are one of the means by which, historically, we've sustained that cultural wisdom that we desperately need today.
Okay, Sean, well, as we begin to draw things to a close for today, I suppose my thought in summary is that there's a storm coming, but there's a dawn coming too. Mm. And we've done this 1,000 times as a species. And I kind of referenced that thought earlier on, and your response was that, you know, quite rightly, that we shouldn't be too glib about this. And that's true. But this isn't something that's new to us. It just, I think, for depending on where we are in the cycle of life and death and existence, sometimes as a species we feel that it's new. We feel that this is the first time this has happened, and why is it happening to us? And this is the worst ever, and why is it so bad? And maybe that's because we're thinking short term, and we've lost track of the memory of our species. I don't know if you'd like to offer any closing thoughts, because ultimately what's very important for me to take away from David's work is this sense of possibility. Yes, we're looking at compromise, without a doubt. We're looking at change. But what's coming out of that more than anything else is getting in touch with something, as I referenced earlier in the show, that we have lost touch with, and that is our, I would even go beyond his phrase, second nature, our true nature. And for me, that's very, very important.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, you're right. We've lived through, as a species, times of civilizational collapse in the past. Hopefully we will do in the future. I mean, there is this element of global climate change to our current predicament, which arguably is taking place in a way that it hasn't before and could have long-term consequences. But in terms of our lifetimes, yes, this is something that we can draw on our species' cultural wisdom to address. And I think that's, yeah, I'm not sure how far you've got into the sort of great work, Lean Logic, as opposed to just the Surviving the Future, which is around a quarter of it. In Surviving the Future, I hope to pull out, I think of it as a kind of gateway drug, if you like, that it gives a taster of David's very nourishing and warm possibility field, as you say, writing, and the framework that he presents for building a better future than the one that we're maybe currently faced with. But in Lean Logic, gets a lot more into many of the nuanced elements of cultural wisdom and of bravery and of mental habits that we've been talking about that are necessary to, as we step into that time. I mean, Lean Logic really is, I mean, it's called A Dictionary for the Future and How to Survive It, and it's the most wide-ranging book I've ever encountered. I mean, it is one of my favourite books ever, so I feel very honoured to be associated with it as the editor. Actually, John Michael Greer has come up a few times in our conversation. He described the book as a monumental achievement, an encyclopedic guide to the crisis of industrial civilization, and I challenge anyone to read as much of a page of it without finding at least one insight worth serious reflection. And I think there's a nice note on which to potentially end this interview. It seems appropriate to give David the last word. And this is very much about the sense of taking responsibility for the times that we're in whatever way makes sense to you, but not just burying your head in the sand and, as John Michael Greer put it, thinking about your children's future by not thinking about it. One of the many threads that runs through David's work is this idea of remembering again how to recognize valid argument and to sift and evaluate that for ourselves. And one of the fallacies, the logical fallacies that he addresses is distraction. So I'd like to read his entry on distraction. Distraction is diverting attention from the argument. Consider the proposition that 2 and 2 makes 4. Distraction might urge, for instance, that the idea is old-fashioned, that the time has come to move on from traditional thinking on the matter, or that it is too technical for the public to understand. It could take the form of an ingratiating assurance that the only thing that matters naturally is the well-being and happiness of everyone concerned. Distraction might urge that it is perfectly okay nowadays to think that 2 plus 2 makes 5, or that even thinking about it means an unforgivable neglect of the far more important proposition that 3 and 4 make 7. You might be invited to take note that there is money to be made by taking a different view of the matter, or that we have to move on from the notion if we are to be competitive, or that the proposition is a bit rich coming from someone with a private life like yours. Or it could insist with some passion that, contrary to the view that 2 plus 2 makes 4, we must take our place at the heart of Europe. Distraction might add, with hoped-for finality, that the argument has already been lost. 2 plus 2 is going to make 5 in the future, whatever we do. This appeal to the inevitable is a characteristic form of distraction, making an assertion which is not true, but which is hard to disagree with. The distractor does not argue for or against a proposal. Instead, he simply asserts that it is going to happen anyway, and he may do so in a slightly bored drawl that passes off the sellout as if it were a routine comment on the weather. Don't stand for this. It is one of the ways in which our citizens' right to have a say in deciding for ourselves dwindles into a loss of belief that we can influence anything at all. It is designed to induce give-up-itis, an acceptance that technology and the sweep of history make the decisions. What we are then supposed to do is to surrender, to make sure we are not in the way.
Sean. Today we've been discussing the work of the British economist David Fleming, in particular two recently published volumes, his masterwork Lean Logic, A Dictionary for the Future and How to Survive It, and the summarized companion piece edited by yourself, which is entitled Surviving the Future, Culture, Carnival and Capital in the Aftermath of the Market Economy. Published by Chelsea Green, both widely available around the world. Just as we wrap things up for today, would you care to share anything about those? Also your own website, any other online resources you'd like to put out there?
So my website is darkoptimism.org. And for those who are interested in reading more about David Fleming's work, his centre was called the Fleming Policy Centre. And if you go to the Fleming Policy Centre on the left-hand side, there's a page all about his posthumous books, and all the reviews are up there, and video footage from an event Rob Hopkins and I did at Schumacher College last month, one with Jonathan Porritt, and that's being updated all the time as the new reviews come in. And there's links there as well to if you want to buy the books anywhere in the world.
Wonderful. Well, Sean, thank you so much for joining us once again on LegalizeFreedom.com.
Absolute pleasure, Greg. Thanks a lot.
Well, folks, that's it for another week. As ever, thank you so much for listening. If you enjoyed the show, check out the website, which is LegalizeFreedom.com. That's Legalize-Freedom.com, where you'll find an archive of programs offering alternative views on a wide range of topics, including politics and economics, energy and environment, culture, spirituality, history, and the nature of reality. You can also browse and buy a range of publications from our guests, and if you're feeling generous, make a donation to help keep the site up and running. Whether you listen, donate, or do both, I greatly appreciate your support. Until next time, I'm Greg Moffat, and you've been listening to LegalizeFreedom.com.